Hello, everybody, and happy Friday. It's me, Miss Natalie. This is Read Along from Kalamazoo Public Library. We are reading The Mark of Athena by Rick Riordan, which is book 3 of the series Heroes of Olympus. As always, we are reading on Hoopla. Now, when we finished up yesterday, our heroes, Jason, Piper, and Percy, found themselves in a pretty bad spot. I guess it's a vision that she's had. Piper's had this through most of the book, which is that of the three of them drowning, even for Percy, who isn't supposed to be able to drown. They finally found themselves inside a nymphaeum. Nymphaeum, I think I'm saying it right. You know, I don't speak Latin. I really got to start looking this stuff up. But the nymphaeum is a place where it's a shrine for nymphs. And these are the original 9 nymphs who saved Zeus from Kronos. The myth being that Kronos had heard before he and his wife Rhea had their children that one of his sons would overthrow him and throw him in Tartarus. So he ate all of his children, gross, swallowed them whole. And Rhea, though, in an attempt to prevent her husband from eating all of her children, she swaddled a big rock, because apparently Kronos is not that bright, gave it to him and said, hey, this is the baby. He took her at her word, didn't even think to verify what she said, and he swallowed the rock. And then she gave Zeus to 9 nymphs to raise. And once he did, then Zeus came back, killed his dad, all of his brothers and sisters popped out, and boom, that's all she wrote. But, yeah, so now these nymphs have been trapped, though, for 2,000 years at this nymphaeum because of, like, weird rules for nymphs that I don't understand, but Percy understood. And they're all desiccated and gross, and they are going to kill the three of them, and it's disgusting. So let's get right into it, because they gotta figure out their way out of here. Piper is not feeling all that hopeful, thinking this is actually how they die, and if Rick Riordan actually kills the three of them, I'm probably going to flip the table that my computer is on. Yeah. Okay. Yay, pictures of my sleepy, beautiful kitty. I decided to go with cuddly pictures during these chapters because, holy crap, these chapters are messing with my emotions. I just want to read about, like, fluffy kitten things. Why did we pick Rick Riordan? His books are really good, though, and they're also super funny. So, I guess you win some, you lose some. But, yay, sleepy kitty pictures. And then, of course, next Wednesday, June 16th at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, is our read-along celebration. I hope you guys are getting excited, because I am super-duper excited. So, we are going to have a Zoom party. I almost said a Zine party, which is not a thing. It's a Zoom party. We are going to meet together, and we're going to talk, and we're going to have me do a little bit of reading live. Yes, live. So awesome. And then we're going to do some, you know, Rick Riordan, Percy Jackson trivia. And then maybe have activities, and mostly just, like, talk to each other and see each other's beautiful faces. It will be fabulous. So, if you live in the Kalamazoo area, you're going to go to kpl.gov. The link is in the description for the YouTube video. It's the doodly-doo thing down there. You're going to click on it, and you're going to register, and then I'll send you guys the link. However, if you are not local, you are still totally welcome to come. You just need to send me an email, the natalie@kpl.gov there, and ask me for the link, and I'm going to email it to you directly. Also, word of warning for all of my friends who have emailed me before but didn't actually ask for this, I'm going to spam you guys and give you the link because I want us to all see each other. It's going to be so much fun. And then finally, contact information. Once again, just in case you didn't hear me before when I said email me, there's my email one more time. Okay, I guess let's find out what happens with Piper, Jason, and Percy. I'm a little bit stressed out over this. Chapter 43. Piper. Piper needed a miracle, not a bedtime story. But right then, standing in shock as black water poured in around her legs, she recalled the legend Aeschylus had mentioned, the story of the flood. Not the Noah story, but the Cherokee version that her father used to tell her, with the dancing ghosts and the skeleton dog. When she was little, she would cuddle next to her dad in his big recliner. She'd gaze out at the windows at the Malibu coastline, and her dad would tell her the story he'd heard from Grandpa Tom back on the res in Oklahoma. "This man had a dog," her father always began.
"You can't start a story that way," Piper protested. "You have to say once upon a time."
Dad laughed. "But this is a Cherokee story. They're pretty straightforward. So anyway, this man had a dog. Every day, the man took his dog to the edge of the lake to get water, and the dog would bark furiously at the lake, like he was mad at it."
"Was he?"
"Be patient, sweetheart. Finally, the man got very annoyed with his dog for barking so much, and he scolded it. 'Bad dog, stop barking at the water. It's only water.' To his surprise, the dog looked right at him and began to talk."
"Our dog can say thank you," Piper volunteered, "and she can bark out."
"Sort of," her dad agreed, "but this dog spoke entire sentences. The dog said, 'One day soon, the storms will come. The waters will rise and everyone will drown. You can save yourself and your family by building a raft. But first, you will need to sacrifice me. You must throw me into the water.'"
"That's terrible," Piper said. "I would never drown my dog."
"The man probably said the same thing. He thought the dog was lying. I mean, once he got over the shock that his dog could talk. When he protested, the dog said, 'If you don't believe me, look at the scruff on my neck. I am already dead.'"
"That's sad. Why are you telling me this?"
"Because you asked me to," her dad reminded her. And indeed, something about the story fascinated Piper. She had heard it dozens of times, but she kept thinking about it. "Anyway," said her dad, "the man grabbed the dog by the scruff of its neck and saw that its skin and fur were already coming apart. Underneath was nothing but bones. The dog was a skeleton dog."
"Gross."
"I agree. So with tears in his eyes, the man said goodbye to his annoying skeleton dog and tossed it into the water, where it promptly sank. The man built a raft, and when the flood came, he and his family survived."
"Without the dog?"
"Yes, without the dog. When the rain subsided and the raft landed, the man and his family were the only ones alive. The man heard sounds from the other side of a hill, like thousands of people laughing and dancing. But when he raced to the top, alas, down below he saw nothing except bones littering the ground. Thousands of skeletons of all the people who had died in the flood. He heard the ghosts of the dead had been dancing. That was the sound he heard." Piper waited.
"And?"
"And nothing. The end."
"You can't end it that way! Why were the ghosts dancing?"
"I don't know," Dad said. "Your grandfather never felt the need to explain. Maybe the ghosts were happy that one family had survived. Maybe they were enjoying the afterlife. They're ghosts. Who can say?" Piper was very unsatisfied with that. She had so many unanswered questions. Did the family ever find another dog? Obviously not all dogs drowned, because she herself had a dog. She couldn't shake the story. She never looked at dogs the same way, wondering if one of them might be a skeleton dog. And she didn't understand why the family had to sacrifice their dog to survive. Sacrificing yourself to save your family seemed like a noble thing, a very dog-like thing to do. Now, in the Nymphaeum in Rome, as the dark water rose to her waist, Piper wondered why the river god Aeschylus had mentioned that story. She wished she had a raft, but she feared she was more like the skeleton dog. She was already dead.
Oh, what? Okay, so, Uncle Rick. Oh, these chapters are so emotional. Okay. I mean, yeah, it's a really tiny chapter, and also it's depressing that we're already done for the week. But on Monday, we will read the next chapter, and there better be something wonderful happening. Okay, enjoy your weekend.